looks like a nice approach. Ground speed is 55 knots, and there's no wind, no ground wind here. It's a little hard landing. See, he's going around. And he stalls. So that was my day today at Old Bridge Airport. Today's November, well, it's November 22nd now. This happened on November 21st. I was in the air right behind this student pilot when this happened. Let's take another look.
Overdraft experimental turning final 2-4 over.
Yeah, when you have a hard bounce like that, you have a couple options. The best option, in my opinion, is usually just to level the nose and let the airplane settle back down on its own. Sometimes when you bounce up like that, it's just because you just came in with a little bit too much speed. Your other option is to do a go around, which is what seems like he did. You're supposed to add power. Keep that nose level, arrest your descent, and once you gain a little bit more speed, retract the flaps, and then pitch for your normal climb out speed. So I was wondering what brought us to this place in life right now, and through the miracles of video, we're able to replay some of the prior flights of the day for this student. Now here he's flying with his CFI. I think they came to the airport, the student came to the airport today knowing that he would probably do some solo flights. And typically what happens is you show the instructor that you can do two or three really good takeoffs and landings. And then he stops you on the runway, he gets out of the aircraft, and he'll watch from the ground. So this is with the CFI. That's a nice, smooth landing. That's professional right there. And if I saw that, if that was my student, I would be signing him off too. You know, granted, he has all of the other training, training about go-arounds. Here's their second flight now. Here's the approach for the second flight this afternoon. Ground speed is 59, 61, 60. There was a little bit of wind up at altitude, not much, maybe 5 or 7 knots, but down at the ground it was calm. Showing 50 now, 47, that looks nice. It flared a little bit too early, but that was very nice as well. That was very nice. And here, I believe, is the third flight with the CFI. . 62 knots, ground speed, 59, 57, 55, 52. Yeah, he came in a little bit faster, so that's why he's not touching down right away. The flare was a little bit nose high, but that's okay. All three of them, I would say, are pretty good. And here you can see me on the taxiway. I'm ready to do some engine testing. I changed my oil and my spark plugs earlier. And so my plan for the day is just to do one flight in the pattern, make sure everything's legit, and pack it away. But as it turned out, the air was super calm. It turned out to be a perfect evening for flying. And so I opted to do a couple more flights in the pattern. So here we're following this aircraft, and if you're a pilot, this has probably happened to you too. Your CFI turns to you and says, yeah, you're ready to do some solo flights, and he might look at your logbook just to make sure that all of the endorsements are properly signed and the language is 100% correct. And I remember with my first solo, it was at Monmouth Executive, which used to be called Belmar, or Alaire. Had I don't know how many different names over the years. And it was a huge airport. The runway was, 8,000 feet. And we're in the middle of nowhere on the airfield. And my instructor just gets out. And, of course, he had his radio with him so he could talk to me if I needed some assistance. But he just got out and said, just keep doing what you've been doing. And I said, sure, I think I could do that. Now, it is a little bit different when you don't have this warm body next to you. And that was the first thing that I noticed when I was doing my solo, is that the temperature in the cabin was different, because now there's only one person in the cabin keeping it warm. So what do I do? The first thing I do is I turn on the heat. So this is the first solo flight this evening. Let's take a look at our speeds, 59, okay. Now, just so you know, the altitude that you see on the map here is pressure altitude, and that's what's reported by ADS-B. The air pressure today was 30.15 inches, so
simulated engine out.
You're going to have to add about 200 feet to the pressure altitude, and that will be your indicated altitude. That's what you see on the dial. And our airfield here, I believe, is 87 feet, so just call it 100 feet. So here too, I think he came in a little bit fast. He floated just a little bit, but that's fine. And he settled down on the ground fairly good. So that was a pretty good, really good first solo flight.
Over Shavistock is turning final, runway 24 at Obis.
This looks like our second solo flight. Now, I'm playing the whole video here because I'm sort of a little bit involved in this too, because I'm following behind him. I'm giving him enough room, and I'm also making some extra radio calls that I don't normally make. Things like, I'm turning downwind. Yes, I have the downwind traffic in sight, just so he knows that, yes, I see him. He doesn't have to worry about me. And before he took off, I sort of heard some chatter on the radio and made it sound like this was one of his first solos. So I said something to him like, you got this. It's 100%. You've been doing good. So he knew I was behind him this evening.
Over, Trust Experimental is turning final. 2-4, over.
And as he's touching down, I'm turning final, so I'm anticipating him to exit the runway by the time I get to the runway. And of course, he pitches up and his speed just keeps decaying until it finally stalls.
Going around, 2-4.
Now, you're on the runway.
Here's where I have a
decision
to make. I see what happened on the runway. Now, I don't know exactly what happened. All I can really make out is that there's an air on the left side of the runway.
Can you hear me?
So my assumption is that he lost directional control on the side. I've seen that happen at our airport a couple of times. I'm hearing this on the radio.
Wait.
And as I'm passing by the aircraft on the ground, I start to see the flames from the cowl. So my initial decision of doing a go around and just orbit for a while until things got sorted out on the ground, when I saw those flames, I'm like, I think I'm of better use on the ground here. My aircraft has a landing distance about 600 feet, and there is 1,500 feet remaining.
Are you okay, Doc?
Past the,
over traffic?
The accident site.
Yeah. Good, we got
so
it.
I opted to and do a high-speed taxi back to the first parking spot that I found. All of the hangars and the cameras mounted to the side of one of the hangars. All of the hangars have two fire extinguisher, you know, full-size fire extinguishers. So my plan now was to park it as quickly as I could and grab one of the fire extinguishers and run back to my hangar, which is where the camera is mounted here, and take my car out to the site. Now, initially when I landed, it sounded pretty urgent. It wasn't clear if he was stuck in there or if...
Echo's on fire just off the runway on 24. You might need a divert.
Hi, roger that. We'll be diverting from other airport. Thank you.
If he was going to be stuck in there or if he was going to be able to make it out. So you can kind of make myself out on the left side of the screen here. And I was able to pull one of the fire extinguishers off the wall. The first one I came to, it was fighting with me. I couldn't pull it off the wall. So I don't know if it was strapped down or what. But the second one, I just gave it all I got and just yanked it off of the wall. And here I am getting in my car and driving directly to the scene. Now, I had just been in the air, and I know that there's no other aircraft in the area. So, yeah, I probably should have stopped and looked, but it seemed a little bit more urgent that I get the fire extinguisher out there as quickly as possible. As I passed by the scene while I was in the air, I did see that golf cart on the side of the runway with the aircraft. And as I looked down the runway, I you know, there's no other ground traffic that would that was trying to get out to the accident site. And all of this happened so fast, I don't think anyone really had a chance to respond that quickly. So I think my landing was pretty safe. But man, let me tell you, by the time I got to this fire, we emptied two or three fire extinguishers, and a fuel-fed fire is going to have none of that. It will just keep going. And that's what that white smoke is that you see coming up is whatever type of fire extinguisher that was. That's the stuff that was burning off from that material. But it became really clear to me what happens when you're involved in an aircraft accident and there's a fire involved. You have a minute to get out. And again, this fire just started in the cowl. It probably broke one of the fuel lines going to the engine. And although I believe the pilot was conscious the entire time, I don't know that he had the wherewithal to, you know, pull the fuel shut off, kill the electrical, and do all of the things that you are taught to do. But in this case, I think the number one thing is just to get out of the aircraft. So I definitely can not blame him at all for leaving things on and just getting out as quickly as he possibly could. So I thought about carrying a fire extinguisher with me in my aircraft, and I probably will, but man, it can put out a really small fire, but that's about it. Again, this started as something pretty small in the engine compartment, and it erupted pretty quickly.
Joe, are you on frequency right now?
Old Bridge Airport information. Please fly right pattern runway 24. Use caution, dear. And geese on runway at Old Bridge Airport. CFR automated weather advisory. Winds calm. Visibility 10. Sky condition. Ceiling 3,500 broken. Temperature 12 Celsius. Dew point 5 Celsius. Altimeter 3014.
Hey, George, is that you up?
Yep.
Listen, you can't land at Old Bridge. We got an incident here, and the runway's closed.
Oh, boy.
So you can go to probably Monmouth County, and I'll pick you up there.
All right, either or. How about Robinsonville?
I can go there, too.
Whichever one's closer for you.
Joe said Monmouth is closer. Take it over to Albert's Flight School.
All right, will do. What happened down there?
I'll talk to you when I see you.
All right.
Yeah, I'm on my way to get you. Bye.
Bye.